Good morning, church. We're going to gather around the table of the Lord. I wonder if I could give you a title for this morning just to tie my thoughts together. Pleased to be seated. I don't do well at events where everything is plastic. I'll tell you a couple of stories. I was at a party recently and I leant back on a plastic chair and the back broke off. And the drink I had in my hand went all over the back of the guests who were seated behind me. On another occasion, true story, I was delicately cutting up a piece of steak on a plastic plate with a plastic knife. The plate folded perfectly in half and slipped down through my legs onto the floor. I don't do well with plastic. Before we get to being seated, I want to talk to you about the word table. I notice that God doesn't do well sharing us with other things. He can and often gets jealous of our heart affections. Have you noticed? Both Jesus and Paul address the issue of trying to have this and that. I confused my dog the other day when I gave him a piece of meat, and about 3 or 4 seconds later, I brought out an even bigger piece of meat. And right there, that moment is why I own a dog. The challenge that he had, do I give up this to get that? I got to tell you something. The world, the flesh, and the devil do that to us all the time. Are you prepared to trade that for this? Jesus said, you cannot serve God and mammon. Now, we can simply just cross out the word mammon and put money. But that's not entirely accurate. What about this? You cannot serve God and find security and comfort and pleasure in earthly things. Because God wants to be our security and our comfort and our pleasure. Paul said that you have been betrothed to just the one husband. The first four commands in Exodus 20 are all about our relationship with him. Our singleness of our relationship with him. But in 1 Corinthians 10, Paul calls the communion celebration the Lord's table. I don't want to draw attention to that just for a moment. In verse 21, he says, you cannot eat the Lord's table and the table of demons. Have you ever been reading Paul's writings, though? What on earth did he mean by that? In his day, it was not uncommon for families to have meals in the presence of and in the honor of their particular gods. And initially, as Jesus was introduced as the Savior of the world, he was just added to the list of deities that were to be celebrated at the mealtime. That's what he was addressing here. Paul was addressing this era with reference to the Lord's table. This table was established by Jesus for us. It is here that we remember, we honor, and we celebrate his sacrifice for sin and our resulting victory over the enemy of our souls, sin and the devil. Hallelujah. Now you'll have heard an MC say, as I just did, please be seated. How many are glad that there was a seat for you to sit in? Please to be seated. You may have even heard someone say, take your seat. An airline ticket tells you exactly where you have to sit. This is one of my dad's. Come on in, boy. Pull up a chair and take a load off your feet. It seems that one of the first things that you do at a wedding reception or function is to see where you are seated. And in turn, who you'll be sitting with. This could determine the rise and fall of your entire evening. Where you're seated and who you're sitting with. In my case, nearest to the buffet or closest to the bridal table. I'm always confused about that. And I remember the time that we spent as a family discussing the seating plans in the weddings that I've been involved with. You wouldn't think it would take that long to seat people appropriately, accordingly, so that nobody gets offended, so everybody feels like they're within reach of the bride and groom. Because you notice the further you get to the back, you feel like the friendship's weaker and weaker and weaker. Would you agree? One warning the scripture gives us is to not choose your own seat. Especially not near the head of the table, lest the host come and ask you to move to a place further down. Luke 14, 8 and 9 says, when someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited the both of you will come to you and say, give this person your seat. It is interesting to notice the times in Scripture that standing and sitting were recorded, especially in relation to God. One that immediately comes to mind is the story of Stephen. In Acts 7:55, we read, but Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. It is one thing to have someone sit up and take notice, but it is a whole nother thing to have someone up out of the chair because what you've said or what you've done. Would you agree? Stephen had the Lord of glory standing up out of his seat. Wow. Another is when Jesus stood to read from the scroll in Luke 4. Verse 20 says, and when he'd finished reading, then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant and sat down. Oh, I'll read the next bit. And the eyes of all who were gathered were fixed upon him. What is this man going to say next? It would appear from Scripture that Jesus sat down when he had finished everything that he had to do. Hebrews 1:3, our key text. The Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful words. After having provided purification for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. This is a fascinating prophecy in Psalm 110, verse 1. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. The New Testament carries the theme in Ephesians 2, 6. And God raised us up out of the muck and mire of sin with Christ to be seated in heavenly places alongside our Savior and our Master because we are united to Christ. That's what this table is all about. In Psalm 23, the writer jumps from us being sheep in a green pasture to being dinner guests at a table. Verse 5 says, you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. Paul let us know that that wasn't human enemies. He said we wrestle against principalities and powers and spiritual hosts of wickedness. We wrestle against sin in our flesh and we wrestle against the broken world that's all around us. And of course we have a real enemy, the devil. He says you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. Do you know that you and I are in this place because of Jesus? We sit here. Our sin's been washed away. The devil has no hold on our soul. Are you glad about that? Hallelujah. Are you pleased to be seated at his table? Hallelujah. He says, you anoint my head with oil. But this is the key one. My cup runneth over. There was a time. This was introduced to me at a restaurant. The idea of the bottomless cup. And you know what I'm talking about? That means you could, the buffet was great. All right, then I got introduced to the bottomless. I could eat all I could, and then I could drink all I could. The idea of the bottomless cup. You could go back for as many refills as you wanted, so long as you had a seat at the table. Just remind me of the emphasis given by Paul at this table. As often as you do this, as often as you return to this table, and take your seat. You can be refilled by God's love and God's grace. You can be reminded that your sins are forgiven. They've been washed away by the blood of Jesus. Are you pleased to have a seat at his table? When Jesus sits down, he said it on the cross, the work is finished. Father said, sit down till I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The devil does a great job of reminding us how bad we are. This table reminds us of how good God is. Forget how bad we are. Any and all sins washed away because of his blood. Hallelujah. Can you ever have too much of God? We used to sing a song which claimed that God was more than enough. And those who've journeyed long with God will often say, he's too much. Not a bad too much. A good too much. We want more. Imagine going to a restaurant. You have a fantastic evening, surrounded by great friends, quality music, and atmosphere. Your table wins the lucky prize. Everyone is cheerfully envious of you and your gathered guests. On your way out, you're met by the owner who wants to refund all your expenses and is excited to invite you back at your earliest convenience. Do you know what this table of the Lord is? It is you being blessed by God, the host of the table. When are you coming back? As often as you do this, the buffet's been put, that's been spread, the table's been spread. You have a bottomless cup of God's grace. His blood is unending, constantly washing away sin. You don't need to feel guilt and shame. We need to experience the grace and mercy of God every time we sit down at this table. Are you pleased to have your seat? Are you pleased to have a seat? I wrote this down about the Old Testament sacrifice and the New Testament sacrifice. Back then, it was so much to cover so little. In the New Testament, it's precious little to cover so much. Let's all stand in his presence. Hallelujah! Peter had it right when he said, by the precious blood of Jesus. Praise your Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this broken body. That is for our healing. He said it's his stripes before our healing. And people are going to partake of your broken body and they're going to receive wholeness today in the name of Jesus. And this blood, a simple symbol in juice, Lord God, of the power and grace of Almighty God being poured out for all mankind, reserving us a seat at your table. Thank you, Jesus. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you, Jesus, for this bottomless cup of grace. Amen. God bless you, saints. And by his wounds I am set free. And by his blood I've been redeemed. The great divine. The
people who want to sit down with him at his table in that day, and they'll come from the north and the south and the east and the west. But if you haven't learned to sit at his table now, don't think you'll be invited to sit at his table then. For he's preparing you for that day when you will find that they'll come from every kindred and every tongue and every tribe. And it will be that his grace will be evident in their lives to all of us. And it won't matter to who, as Pastor Greg has shared, who we're sitting next to, because we'll be sitting next to the redeemed, the blood washed just like ourselves. And we'll find that each one's cup will be full and running over. Hallelujah. Blessed be his lovely name. So endeavor to come, as he says, come and receive from me this day. Come and receive from me this day. For that which he has for you is received by faith. And as you receive it, it will manifest. His grace will manifest with much mercy towards you, because he loves you so much. One of my favorite scriptures is in Ephesians 2 verse 4, where it says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for the great love wherewith he hath loved us. He loves you and will shower his mercy abundantly upon you. And everybody said, as we're seated, sing the chorus just once more. By his wounds I am set free. By his blood I've been redeemed. Oh, praise the great divide you cross for me. Oh, they got to sing it again. What you have for me today. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And everybody said, come on, big shout, amen. Amen. Let's do the offering.
Good morning, church. Wow. Thank you for that word of encouragement, Pastor Greg. Wonderful. How good is our God? You know, we learn by experiences. We also learn from others. You know, and I have found the best way to learn from others is to learn from others. It does not hurt as much.
Microphone.
Am I right? We learn from our fathers, and we learn by reading the Word of God. We learn by understanding the Word of God, taking care not to fall into the same traps as others have. Example. This is a long time ago, but try to put it into your life. 40 years in the wilderness, the Israelites wandered. The track wasn't really that far away, but the key word is the wilderness. Wilderness speaks of loss, time of learning, where they lost their spirits, Were they lost in their own attitude and murmuring? That's what the word says, isn't it? Did they lose their way of how to get close to God? 40 years, remember. This may be why it took so long for them to arrive in the promised land. God's word has been written down for us to learn from experiences of others and how God's way works with the best outcomes. My point about tithes and offerings today is God's way is truth. God's way works. All things work together for good to them who are the called according to his purposes, and here's the clincher, by Christ Jesus. We are the called. To learn to do things God's way can only do us good. God's way brings stability and favor. God's way brings blessing at the time that we can handle it. God's way brings a passion to be right, to do right in life with honorable outcomes. God's way teaches us who we are and what the path of life is all about. God's way helps us to recognize his goodness. So with our tithes in mind today, God says, try me in this. Taste and see that the Lord is good. As we give with the right attitude, our expectations are powered up in the right direction. I'd like you to take out what your purpose to give today and what we've all given online or whatever we do. But Father, we give this to you. Lord, we want to do the right thing in your eyes, Father. Father, we want to learn how to do it right in your eyes. Lord, that you, Father, are our source, and our expectation, oh Father, of you is powered up. Father, we give this to you today for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you'd like to look to the screens, you can watch the announcement.
Church, what a blessing it is to be in the Lord's house together today. My name is Eilish, and it is so great to have you here with us. Let's take a look at what's happening. Face-to-face connect groups are continuing in term 4, starting this week. Grab a flyer from the info stand or contact the church office for more info. Deacons and men of the house, mark in your calendar for Friday the 23rd of October. You are having a night with Pastor Claude, starting with a meal at 6 p.m. Register online through Vantage Forms or at the info desk. 60s Plus is happening this week. Here are all the details. We have some very exciting news. Pastor Shane Willer will be here with us November the 6th, 7th and 8th. Full details will be coming soon, but we wanted to give everyone lots of notice so you can save the dates. If you are wanting to be baptized in water, see a pastor today. That is all for church news this week. We pray you have a blessed week and don't forget to reserve your seat for next Sunday.
Hallelujah. Praise God. What a joy it was to be in his presence. Do you know, I would have just loved to continue the services just in worship as we have and sense the presence of God today. Well, my wife and I had a week off and we went to Ellie Beach, first time for us. And then we got on a choppy while we were there and went out to the reef. The reef was magnificent. The tide was out
and there's an ocean river flying through the parting through the middle of the reef. Maybe we could show you some photos of that in the days to come. Not about our journey, but just. And I was flying over the top of that reef with our helicopter pilot. Alva was in the back and I'm in the front. And I said, do you know when he created all this, he said, it's good. And all I can say is, amen. It was good. So bless God. But we've had a nice refreshing time for a week while we're away, and we've enjoyed each other's company as we always do. And it's great to be with you today. My heart was touched this week as I began to read the scriptures, because God began to move upon my life in a fresh way. And I love the freshness. Don't you love the freshness of the Spirit that comes to your heart and to your life as He makes the Word live as you read it? And there's a scripture out of Nahum, if I'd like you to turn and start with me there, please. For in the book of Nahum, you may not know this, but he was a prophet that followed up Jonah. 150 years approximately before, Jonah was sent by God to pronounce judgment upon the city of Nineveh because of their wickedness. And he said within 40 days, judgment would come. And it was that the people repented. It was that the people put themselves in sackcloth and ashes. And they said, maybe God will relent. Maybe God will change his mind. And it was that when God saw their repentant hearts, that he changed his mind and spared the city amazingly. But it was 150 years later that people forgot the revival that came. People forgot the goodness and the kind of God. And of course, it was that God being slow to anger, as the scripture says in Nahum chapter 1 verse 3, the Lord who is slow to anger and in great power will not at all acquit the wicked. When we consider the world today and the terrible things that are happening, if I was to ask people their perception of what they think God is like, most of them would never give me the right answer. And the scriptures tells us very clearly that God is good. Everybody say it with me, God is good. In Nahum chapter 1 verse 7, the scripture says this, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knows those who trust in him. Everybody say that with me, that the Lord is good. Do you know it is the goodness of God, it's the kindness of God that brings men and women to repentance, according to Romans 2 verse 4. And then the scripture also tells us in Romans 11 verse 22 that we should behold the goodness and the severity of God. We need to consider both. But you need to consider deep within your own walk with God, because you're here in the house of God today, that God is a good God. Not only is he good, he's just. Not only is he just, he's holy. Not only is he holy, God is love. And God is good. When I look into the scriptures, when the disciples came to Jesus and they said, Lord, teach us to pray, I understand from this what we would term as the Lord's Prayer, the God the Father's interested in our personal well-being. When we look into the scriptures and Jesus taught us how to pray, we can see that God is interested in our personal well-being, our personal happiness. For Jesus taught us to pray this way, and the way that he taught us to pray is that we should pray about our provision, we should pray about our protection, and we should pray about our deliverance. And it is that when we come to the Heavenly Father, he's able to provide, he's able to protect, and he's able to deliver. Anybody that wants to do that for me has to be good. It's clear from the scriptures, as you and I understand this, that the Bible says that there's one God and one mediator between men and God, and it's the man, Jesus Christ. He is the one that is between us. He's the mediator, and it's by him that we have access into the Father's presence. We who have followed Christ for many years and looked at the scriptures, we understand where Jesus is today. And Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. Acts 2 verse 33, Hebrews 1 verse 3, and chapter 10 verse 12. That's where Jesus is right now. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. But it's important for you to know and for me to know today that Jesus is not at the Father's right hand trying to convince a reluctant God to do something for us.
I want you to know that if Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, and the scripture tells us that he's there making intercession for us, God's Son is not somehow trying to convince a reluctant God to do something for us. In John's Gospel, if you turn with me to John chapter 16, you will find that Jesus, in talking to his disciples at the Last Supper, has these important words. And he says in verse 26, "In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I shall pray the Father for you." In other words, sometimes people get an image of that when Jesus is at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. If you could imagine that here is Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Now, Lord, you have to help Simon, and you have to help Mark, and you need to help Ivan, and you need to do something for them. It's not like that Jesus is pleading to his Father that he would do something for us. It is, if I look into the scriptures and I see the word of God, I begin to understand that Jesus there being in the Father's presence, just the fact that he is in the Father's presence, his intercessory work is already accomplished. When Jesus said, "It is finished," it was done. And it's his presence at the right hand of the Father that is the intercessory work. He loves you and he cares for you and he is for you. And the scripture goes on to say in this passage of scripture, please notice this, and I do not say to you that I shall pray to the Father for you. In other words, Jesus is not at the Father's right hand saying things to the Father about me. Help Claude. Will you help Claude? Please help Claude. Do something for Claude. Do something for Ivan. Oh, please do something for them. Jesus said, I'm not even going to say it. I'm just going to be in the Father's presence. Look at me with me to the book of Hebrews, please, just for a moment. I think it's Hebrews chapter 10. You will find in this passage of scripture in Hebrews chapter 10 that Jesus, where he is today. And it is in this word here that you need to grasp a hold of this, because the Bible says in verse 26 of Hebrews chapter 9, that for he then would have suffered often since the foundation of the world, but now once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Once Jesus was manifested to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Now, if you have a look at verse 24, it says here, "But now into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us." Jesus is in the presence of God for us. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. He's just there representing us to the Father, us who believe in the Son. Look at this, and in verse 28 it says, and those that eagerly wait for him shall he appear the second time. He has appeared, he is appearing, and he will appear when he comes again. I don't know if many of you watched Zoom of our wonderful brother from the who comes and speaks of end times. But it is, you must remember this, that you need to be ready. For those that look for him shall he appear the second time. So he will appear. He has appeared, he is appearing, and he will appear. But it is that you must understand that I can't imagine Elva's name being on the lips of my Savior. Just because she believes in him and she loves him, he now represents her and he represents every one of us individually who believe in him. And just for the fact of his presence being at the right hand of the Father, that is his intercessory work. He's atoned for our sins once, and now he's appearing in the presence of the Father for us. And at that time, Jesus says, when you ask the Father, listen, when you ask the Father, I'm not going to ask for you. Have a look at the next verse with me in John chapter 20 and John chapter 16. For Jesus tells us why he won't have to say anything. In John chapter 16, verse 27, for the Father himself loves you because you loved me and have believed that I came from God. And I came forth from the Father and have come into the world. And again, I leave the world and go to the Father. Because we have believed in his Son. The Bible says here that Jesus says, the Father loves you because you have loved me. Because you have loved me, the Lord Jesus. That's the Lord Jesus speaking. Because you have loved me, my Father will love you. When I look at the scriptures and I see this wonderful truth, and it says that he will love me because the Father, I love the Son. Am I asking a question for you today? Are you in love with Jesus? I mean, seriously, do you love the Savior? Where there is love, there is commitment. Where there is commitment, there is service. Where there is service, there is sacrifice. And we find that in these days in which we are living, that we need to understand that the evidence of our love for the Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, is seen in our commitment to him and our service to him and our sacrifice because of him. There is in life, we understand that God requires of us and looks for us, but commitment can only come out of love. When I married my wife some 54, nearly 55 years ago, I made a commitment, and that commitment required service and sacrifice on my behalf. And so it is that when you're in love with somebody, there'll be commitment. When there's commitment, there'll be service. And where there's service, there'll be sacrifice. But it'll come out of a heart of love. Do you remember it was that David, when the plague was moving through the land, and God showed him what to do, and it was that he wanted to buy a parcel of land that he might offer a sacrifice to God. And the man so respected King David, he said, here, I'll give you the land. And he says, will my sacrifice cost me nothing? What it is today about the Christian church in the West that they don't understand the aspect of sacrifice. What is it today of the Christian church in the West that the church is only a cafeteria where you can go and get something and then walk away, but give nothing, serve nobody? It is that in the kingdom of God, with commitment, there is service and there is sacrifice. And that's the evidence that one loves the Son. And when the Father sees that we love the Son, he will love us. So we have direct access to the Father through the Son, as the Scripture makes it very clear. And I want you to know that God is not reluctant. Not reluctant, because God loves you because you love his Son. God loves you because you love his Son. People would tell me, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that you would love his Son, because it's he alone that atoned for our sin, that we might find ourselves reconciled to God and walking in a relationship with him. When I love this scripture so much, and I consider that the Father loves me and loves you because we love Jesus and believe that he came from the Father. This is what Paul said about in Colossians chapter 4 when he said, I want to speak of the mystery of Christ. As John the Baptist said, I was before him, but he's preferred before me because before me he was. In other words, Jesus came from heaven and now has gone back to heaven for you and for me. And there in the presence of God, having believed in Jesus, the Father begins to lavish his love upon you. Does everybody say with me, God is good. If you want to experience the love of God, you know it was that I experienced the mercy of God when I got saved because God loved me. But now in loving his Son, by believing in his Son, in Jesus Christ alone for the salvation of my soul, I've now find that the Father just loves me so much more because I love his Son. The Father loves you so much more because you love his Son. The Father loves you so much more. Oh, he loves the sinner and he wants him to be saved. But the Father loves you so much more because you love his Son. In loving his Son, there is commitment to him. He's the Lord of your life. In loving his Son, the Bible says that he purged our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. We want to serve the Son. It is that in loving the Son and serving the Son, we'll bring the sacrifices of praise and the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we'll give our very best because we love him. I give my best to my wife because I love her. I wonder if I could ask you today just simply, what gives you the greatest cause for rejoicing? What gives you the greatest cause for rejoicing? In Luke chapter 10, the Lord Jesus sent his 70 disciples out. And the scripture says in verse 17, they returned with joy and saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And he said, I saw him fall like lightning from heaven. I saw Satan being pulled down. And he said, and behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. What gives you the greatest cause for rejoicing? That your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. The Bible talks about it in Revelation 3 verse 5, in Revelation 13 verse 8, in Revelation 17 verse 8, in Revelation 20 verse 12, in Revelation 20 verse 15, in Revelation 21 verse 27. The Bible talks about the book of life, and it's called the Lamb's book of life. And he said, this should be your greatest cause for rejoicing, that your name is written down in heaven. Remember the scripture that I gave to you firstly out of this morning, out of Nahum. You might understand that that from that passage of scripture that he says, and the Lord quickened this passage of scripture to me so strongly to me this week. Listen, the Lord is good. I want to develop further later on. Stronghold in the day of trouble. And he knows those who trust him. Your name is written down in heaven. That's your testimony. That's the cause for your greatest rejoicing. For me, over the years of my walking with the Lord, because it's easy at times in the blessing of God, in the goodness of God, to drift. You know that we can drift. We can drift from our commitment. We can drift from our service. We can drift from our sacrifice. But I find that I've never drifted very far, because I've come back to this central point. The greatest cause for my rejoicing is not his blessing in my life, but my name is written down in heaven in the Lamb's book of life. What gives you the greatest cause for rejoicing? That your name is written down in heaven because you love the Son and believe in the Son, believe in the sacrifice, the atoning sacrifice that he made for you at Calvary. Therefore, then, the Father will love you more. Not as a sinner to be saved, but as a saint to be blessed. He will love you more. Everybody say, he will love me more. When I look into the scriptures and I see the wonder of this, and it causes my heart to rejoice. What did Jesus say when a man came to him in Mark chapter 12? Turn with me there in that passage of scripture. In Mark chapter 12, verse 28 to 31, it tells us here that a man came to him and a scribe came to him and having heard them reasoning, perceived that he had the answer them well, asked, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus said, hear, first of all of the commandments, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Do you notice that he didn't give a third commandment that you should love yourself? He only gave two, that we should love him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind. What is the basis? How do we get to that place of loving God? Because we recognize that our name has been written down in heaven. And this is the greatest cause of rejoicing. And it is this cause of rejoicing that keeps me from drifting. To stay committed to him and of being committed to him with service and sacrifice. I find that the Father's responding to his with love toward me because he cares about my provision. He cares about my protection and he cares about my deliverance. The Father cares. That's why Jesus, you see, the Father is interested in your personal relationship and your devotion to his Son. And so when you talk to the Father knows you love the Son, and he will love you because you love his Son. when I think about service and commitment and love. Have a look at this passage of scripture in 1 Peter. In 1 Peter chapter 1, the word of God tells us here in verse 22, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth. There's a purification that comes about, a work of sanctification that comes about in obedience. And seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren. Love one another fervently with a pure heart. How should we love one another? We should love one another fervently. Come on. How should we love one another? We should love one another fervently. How should we love one another? Remember, these two commandments Jesus gave, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor, your brother, your sister, with a pure heart fervently. Everybody say, with a pure heart fervently. I mean, this is where sacrifice comes from, because it's one of love. Turn with me, please, to Romans. In the book of Romans, you'll find in 12, after Paul is, chapter 12, after Paul is sharing this wonderful truth, sharing this wonderful truth about the amazing wisdom and the wisdom and the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are His ways, and they're past finding out. God begins to give us a strategy and a plan for the redemption of humanity and the restoration of the children of Israel, that they will come to saving grace. And then He says, therefore, brethren, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to the world. Be not conformed to the world. And the old Phillips translation says this: don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. Stay in love with God, son. Stay in love with God's son. And God will love you. And God will bless you. And God will take care of you. Everybody say it. If I stay in love with God's son, God will love me and take care of me. When I consider these wonderful truths, and I consider, I believe it's the very same for marriage. How that longevity in marriage, how do you keep that love that you once found when you were young? I look at the young couples that are married and their love is so fervent for one another. And I look at those, recently I was talking to a couple who've got engaged, and their fervent love is evident to all on Facebook. And some have been saying, enough is enough. And I'm thinking, those who wrote little comments like that need to discover their fervent love again. Everybody say amen. So it is that when we consider that we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, that we be transformed. Everybody say, be transformed by the renewing of our minds. It's our love for the Savior. It's our devotion to Jesus. It's our obedience to Him. And it's because of our love of the sacrifices that we make. We don't let the world shape us. You know, there's a real danger the world can shape us. You know why it can shape us? Because, you see, God made us in His image, but we better not make God in our image. God can. You know what the world's trying to do? They're trying to make God in their image. You watch the TV programs, God in their image. What are they saying? Out of a sinful, wicked heart, they're wanting to make God in their image. God is holy. God is just. God is loving. God is right. God is pure. We can't allow us being made in God's image. Now, in our fallen state, we make God in our image. It's as we behold Him that we're changed into His image. We're transformed into His image and His likeness. I'm talking about the heart. Everybody say, Pastor is talking about the heart. In sharing this with you today, there's another passage of Scripture connected to this that the Lord brought strongly to my life, and it's found in the book of James, chapter 5. And in the book of James, chapter 5, the Word of God says this: if any among you are sick, let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, and anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. Don't you love the I wills? Listen to this. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. There's three I wills there. I don't know if you mark your Bible, but you should mark them. He will. Everybody say, he will. And then it says in this passage of Scripture, because it caught my attention the other day as I was just meditating and reflecting, confess your trespasses, or as the old King James says, confess your faults to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And if in this day our prayers ever need to be effectual and fervent, because our love is fervent, then you'll find that your effectual, fervent prayers will be able to avail much. And he gives the illustration of Elijah, who was just like us, no different. He wasn't a superhuman saint. He was just a man who was walking in obedience to God. But as I looked at this passage of Scripture, and I considered this, and I considered the meaning of this word trespass, some translations say sin, but the Scripture says the verse before, if he hath committed sins, they'll be forgiven him. And it says, if you confess your sins, and that's not a correct translation. If you confess your faults, even that's not a correct. Well, what is he saying here? And as I began to reflect and meditate upon him, the Lord began to say to me, son, it's the offenses that people have held in their hearts. It's the offenses that people have held in their hearts. We don't live in a perfect world. We live in a fallen world. And Jesus said, offenses are going to come. And it is that when offenses come, the danger is that you can hold on to them. The danger is that you can. Look, over the years, I've had to deal with the offenses that have come to me because of the preaching of the gospel. I've had to deal with offenses that people have spoken of me because I've remained firm and steadfast in my commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is in that that offenses can come. And people can say things about you and do things in relationship to you, to injure you and to whatever, and you can take up an offense. It is in this that the Lord began to speak to me, is that we need to hand over our offenses to God. Jesus said this, blessed are those who are not offended because of me. Some people are offended because God didn't do what they thought he would do. They didn't think that they're offended because of what Jesus said. Are you offended about what Jesus says? Are you offended when you read the scriptures, or you quickly pass it on when you feel that the prick of the spirit about something he says that you need to address? And so it is that we can be offended for many reasons. But as I look into the scriptures, the Lord began to speak to me and say, you know, that these offenses that you've held on to, you need to give them over, you need to give them up. Have you ever considered that God is interested in defending you? Have you ever considered that God is interested in blessing you and justifying you? As I look into the scriptures and I consider in the passage of scripture of Luke 13, or 18 I should say, it was that the Lord Jesus speaks about an unjust judge, and a woman came to him and asking for justice. In fact, she said, give me justice from my adversary. And the Bible talks about in this, and he's in relating this to prayer, he says in this passage of scripture that he didn't care about God and he didn't care about man, but this woman continually troubled him and she wanted justice. Another word for that was vengeance. And it said, by a weary coming to me. So he said, I don't fear God or man, but I'm going to give it to her. And Jesus says this in verse 8, I tell you the truth, that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? If you look into the scriptures, God is a God of justice. And he's seen the unjust that has been done to you, that's been said about you. But if you take up those offenses and you hold them to yourself, you'll not experience the wholeness, and they're going to come. I wish I could keep you from offenses. I wish I could keep you from taking up offenses or what people say about you or what people are trying to do to you. I wish you wouldn't take up. Remember that God is the just and the justifier of them that believe in Jesus. I've found with people in my life who will hand over their offenses to God and leave it in the hands of God and give me justice. As I can't give you some of the illustrations because they're too personal. But I could easily tell you a number of illustrations where God, something was done and something was said, and I had to hand over the offense to the Lord and leave it with Him, and asking for justice, because you know that this isn't true. Listen to me. God began to put His hand upon me and began to bless me and began to elevate me, because I handed over. And those who were speaking against me and those who were trying to do something wrong to me, do you understand? They couldn't touch me because He was my protector. He was my deliverer. He was my provider. And the Bible says He's the just and the justifier of them that believe in Jesus. Somebody say amen. You can't hold on. And so there can be so many wounded Christians that are holding on to offenses that have been said about them, heard things that they have heard, things that have been done to them. Give them over to the Son. Let them go and ask for justice. Come with me to the book of Romans, chapter 8. It is that the apostle is talking like this. And listen to what he has to say in Romans 8, verse 31. What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all. How shall He not with Him freely give us all things? And who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It's God who justifies. Everybody say it, it's God who justifies. We can get so wounded because of this fallen world that we're living in. Do you realize it's God who will justify you? You don't have to justify yourself. As you hand the offense over to God, you know there's no validity, there's no truth in it, and you hand it over to God. Just let it go. Do you realize that that's what Jesus did at Calvary when He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. That's what Stephen did when he pulled his cloak over his head and said, don't lay this sin to their charge. You know, when Jesus did that, He spoiled principalities and powers. He disarmed them. When you hand it over to God, you disarm your enemies. And God begins to justify you and places. Listen to this. Who'll bring a charge against God's elect? It's God who justifies. Who is He who condemns? It is Christ who died and further is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. There's that word again. But the Father is not saying, oh, please, Father, help Elba. Oh, please, help Ivan. Oh, please, help. Who am I looking at? Brett. Oh, please. It's just the fact of His intercessory presence having atoned for your salvation, and you believe in Him and you love Him and you're committed to Him, and the Father looks at the Son and the Son's just there representing you and me, and the Father sees you love the Son and the Father starts to love you, and the Bible says He's the just and the justifier of them that believe in Jesus. Stop trying to defend yourself. He will defend you. Now, as I looked into this passage of Scripture, it's right for you to cry out for justice, as the woman did in your prayer time. But hand it over. Hand over the offense. Because He's the just and the justifier that will believe in Jesus. You'll never win while you're trying to justify yourself. But He will give you the victory, for His hand will be evident upon your life. I want you to look at this verse, and I want them to put it on the screen. Can I have the singers and the musicians to come? For I find in this passage of Scripture, in the book of James, that in verse 16 in the Amplified Bible, have a look at this with me on the screen. Confess to one another, therefore, your faults, your slips, your false steps, your offenses, your sins. I've said it to you that in this sense, that if a person needs healing within their lives, then they can come, and if the elders will pray the prayer of faith, they'll be healed. Will. And if they've committed sins, will be forgiven them. And then he goes back on to confessing again. Listen to me. I've said it's offense. But watch this now. This is what I want to show you. Offense. And that you pray also for one another, that you may be healed and restored to a spiritual tone of mind and heart. To a spiritual tone of mind and heart. Listen, the earnest, the spiritual tone of mind and heart. My life, my heart has a song. It has a tone. And it's full of gratitude and thankfulness. Because my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Listen, listen. And God the Father loves me. And because I believe in Jesus, it is He that justifies me. And it's He that begins to lift me up and lifts up my head above my enemies and sets a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and my cup will run over. Stand with me together in His presence. I asked you to, dear ones, today that you must remember that God is good and He knows those that are His. And that God, being good, sent His Son into this world. His Son calls Himself the Good Shepherd. And sending His Son into this world, that He could atone for our sin, that we know what God is like, that we dare to believe in Jesus, and we call upon His name, and we open our hearts to Him, and we commit our lives to Him, to follow Him, and we want to serve Him because we're committed, and we're happy to make sacrifices freely, willingly, not because we have to, but because we want to, because we're in love with Him. And the Father says, oh, I love those people because they love my Son. I love them because they love my Son. And here's the Son in the presence of the Father for us. The Son that we love. The Lord and Savior that we adore, that we worship. And the Father sees us loving the Son, and He loves us. And the Son doesn't have to say anything to the Father because the Father sees that we're loving the Son. He doesn't have to say a thing to the Father. The Father says, you love my Son whom I sent. You love Him. I can see that you love Him. But as we go through life, and it isn't easy on our journey at times, offenses come. We don't understand. I do my best. I wish people would know I care. I wish people know I didn't do that intentionally. I wish people would know that somehow, but it seems to be what I've said and what I'm doing is misunderstood, and it's been taken out of context. And that's what you're feeling within yourself, and you're suddenly holding on to the offenses. And who can justify me? Who can justify me of these things? There is one. His name is God the Father. Because you see, the Bible says this: God is the just and the justifier of them that believe in Jesus. And He'll begin to lift you up. He'll begin to lift you up. And He'll lift up your head above your enemies. He'll begin to lift you up. And He'll put, and they'll look and they'll say, I tried to bring Him down, but He's rising higher. I tried to hinder Him from growing, but He's expanding and enlarging. I tried to stop Him. The people wouldn't follow Him and believe in Him. I thought that people would ignore Him. But what's happening? Because the grace of the Father is working toward the one who loves the Son. And it's the Father who loves you, who will justify you, because you love the Son. When you suddenly find that these offenses come and you say, will you justify me? Will you? Who will justify me? You go before the judge and will you justify me? Father, help me. Help me. My name is bad in the city. My name is bad in business. My name is bad. I've got a bad reputation. Father, I'm not talking about you now doing the wrong thing if you've got a bad name. But Father, I'm doing that which is right. I hand it over to you. Will you justify your servant? Can I have that scripture back on the board? For it says, if we confess our offenses, listen, and pray for one another that you may be healed and restored to a spiritual tone of mind and heart. By His wounds I've been set free. Come on. And by His blood I am redeemed. Sing it with me now.
The great divine He crossed for me.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, praise the God of Calvary.
Oh, love the Son, love the Son. And by His wounds
I am set free.
Oh, and by His blood
I've been redeemed.
I've season to let God bring a fresh spiritual tone to your heart and to your mind, an earnestness of commitment, of service, of sacrifice, because you love the Son. I ask in this season that you think on this, and that you let God justify you, and let there come a new spiritual tone within your heart. What stopped me drifting over the years is not the blessing and the favor of God, is but my name is written down in heaven. My name is written down. What causes me the greatest rejoicing? That I'm saved. That He's given me the gift of eternal life. And it's bursting within my heart and within my life. Blessed be His wonderful name. This morning, as we come to the close of the service, I want you to lift your hands. There's a lot of things that are going to happen in this month. Men, I want to meet with you. And the next month, Brother David Sumrall's coming. We're having baptismal services on Saturday, this coming Saturday, and in a couple of weeks' time again. And then we're planning to do something different about our gatherings, if we can, in November. But look, we want you to be in prayer. Everybody say, I need to be in prayer. And I'm going to come in prayer with thanksgiving, with an open heart to Him. But I want you to lift your hands, and I pray today, Father, that people have heard what I've said, the word that you've given, because you are good, and that you love them because they believe in your Son, and that they will roll away these offenses from them and stand before you. For you are the one who justified. You're not the one who condemns. And you are the one who sent your Son to die, and yet furthermore is risen from the dead and makes intercession for us. Hallelujah. Now let His grace that brought salvation to a heart, and let His love that moved Him to do it, and let the Holy Ghost commune with each and every one of you this morning. In Jesus' name.